Hello, this is Ham Radio Now. Episode number 415. We're going to talk about FCC reallocation proposed for the 3 gigahertz and potentially the 5 gigahertz band as well. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and I'm coming to you live this morning. It's January 5th, 2020. This will be the first show of the year, but not the last, I promise. I have a couple guests today, and want to talk about this proposed reallocation of these 3 gigahertz and potentially 5 gigahertz spectrum, of which we're actually using in amateur radio. And I've been involved in a little bit of this, the deployment of mesh network, specifically Arden, and I guess there's some other technologies that use it as well. And so I will bring in my guests today. We'll start here with Andre Hansen, K6AH. Hey, thanks for joining me today, Andre.
It's my pleasure, David.
And we met before briefly. You lectured at Torrance at Hamfest that we sponsored out here, I think PacificCon 2 or 3 years ago. I was out there and got to meet you. I heard a great talk. You had a nice dish set up in the window there pointing at something. I don't remember exactly what it was. And I was impressed back then, and we've kind of dived into it here with our Ares group, and we've been helping build out some of the stuff in the Southern California area. I know you're building out a lot of stuff south, I guess, is San Diego County and surrounds?
Yeah, San Diego and Riverside counties, yeah.
Okay, yep. Great. In addition to Andre, I have, got to go over there, Jim Aspinwall joining us again. Good morning, Jim. How are you doing?
Good. How are you, David?
Good. I'm going to have to change this to like irregular co-host or regular co-host pretty soon. How's it going up there in the Bay Area?
Great. Nice sunshiny day here. A little background noise. Somebody's printing something. So this we'll try and stop that distraction.
I don't hear it at all. So that's a good thing. We also have in and out David Erickson, KB5UGF. If he's able to jump back in, he will. But if not, I want to just dive right into this and talk about what's going on here. So, Andre, why don't you start? I've got a couple letters, and I will show you guys the Arden website, and you can go look at this on your own at www.ardenmesh.org. And right on the front homepage, there's this call to action defense of the Part 97 allocations. Andre, tell us a little bit about what's going on here.
Yeah, thank you, David. Well, as I'm sure just about everybody's heard, the FCC is wanting to take away the 3 gigahertz band, at least a significant portion of it, and auction it off to the highest bidders, which inevitably will be the carriers that are delivering internet access via cell service. And it's real unfortunate because this 3 gigahertz band is the only one that Arden can use without Part 15 and read that commercial allocation. So when you look at the bands that that Arden can be used on, 900 megahertz is a very narrow band, not particularly usable, shared with lots of instrumentation and paging systems and the like. 2 gigahertz, we have really one channel that that can be used there, which doesn't have Wi-Fi interference. 5 gigahertz obviously has Wi-Fi interference also, but there is a segment on the upper end of that band that hams have for themselves. That also, under another proposal, is being discussed to do similar things with. And that leaves 3 gigahertz. Now, 3 gigahertz in some parts of the world is used for Wi-Fi-like activities. And as a result, there is one company, Ubiquiti, that manufactures a 3 gigahertz wireless router that we have been able to customize and move into the ham band. And the benefit of that band in particular is that there is no commercial interference. So when you're up, if you're up on a mountaintop and you've designed a network, as I described in QST back in 2017, you will define a backbone, and from that backbone you will drop down to a mid-mile or a relay tier of the network, and then finally down to deployed hams or fixed facilities. And to have a band that you're not competing with commercial interests on makes all the difference in the world. Normally, when we're on the high ground to build this backbone, that's exactly the same place as wireless ISPs are delivering their internet service to their customers.
So let me ask, my understanding, 3 gigahertz, are we the only game in town in the U.S. or are the WISPs secondary. Using it? We're secondary. Okay.
We're secondary to government and military, really only in certain areas where they have a specific type of radar installation. And frankly, I'm not particularly knowledgeable on that radar. I've never encountered it. And to my knowledge, I've never interfered with it, but, it does exist.
But to have the
band available for that purpose makes all the difference in the world. We're supporting links of 50 miles or more on 3 gigahertz.
Right. But the wireless internet service providers, the WISPs, they're using more 5 gigahertz stuff.
And 5 gigahertz and 2.4.
So they're not using the 3 gigahertz. So we don't have any competition right now in those areas.
Right.
But the proposal is to sell off parts of that for cellular service providers, and maybe for the WISPs to use to expand their footprints or serviceability. Yep. Okay, got it. And right now, as far as that equipment's concerned, the stuff that we're doing on 3.4 is the long haul. Those longer links to get the, as you said, the backbone from this mountaintop to the other, so that folks down below it can talk mountain to mountain and cover a longer range, right? So,
well, that's certainly how I've designed my networks. It's the way I've described the best practice to be. Now, whether all Arden implementers are doing that or not, I can't answer that. I mean, I do see the hundreds of 3 gigahertz implementations on the Arden map. To that extent, I know that it's being used countrywide. You could build links on 5 gigahertz in that ham only reserved space at the very top end of the band.
Right. And this is the map that you're talking about, or at least a screenshot of this map. I know on the Arden site, you can go and pull up this whole interactive map and look at the Google Earth maps or this live view, and it'll show you kind of what's going on. I think this is cool. I've seen this, kind of grow over the years I've been following this. So there is quite a bit of 3 gigahertz deployments out there.
Yeah, I think the 3 gigahertz spots are actually buried below the
below the other ones.
But you can also unselect all the other bands and choose only the 3 gigahertz.
Got it. See it there. So you can see where those are. So we're starting to cover across the country. But I guess the concern is if they start selling this off, you think they're going to pull our allocations, so we won't even be able to access anymore, or we would be sharing with.
They're certainly going to pull the existing allocation, 3.3 to 3.5. There is a suggestion in their proposal that they'd like to move everybody, and I don't think they are even remotely aware of what Arden is doing in the band. Mm-hmm. I'm not even sure they understand what Arden is as a ham technology. Mm-hmm. So, we're challenged with the education of the FCC there. But
wanting to move us wouldn't really make a difference, because the equipment that we're using today, out of the box, the way it stands, it's not capable of doing that, as I understand.
Well, so they're suggesting that we could move down to the 3.1 to 3.3 mm-hmm. subband. We've looked at that, and the equipment that we've torn apart and actually swept is indicating that it's not going to be movable down there. There are actual mm-hmm. Filters, hardware filters on the board that prevent its operation down there. Now, is there a way of modifying those devices with different filters, perhaps? You know, when you get down to that sort of level of you know, physically modifying the hardware of a manufacturer, you know, there are costs that are going to be substantial in doing so, and if it's even feasible.
Right, and you're talking about taking it out of the, you know, the amateurs like me. Yeah, I have a soldering iron, and I can do some of that stuff, but there's probably a big barrier if you're telling me I've got to take equipment out and, you know, add a resistor, or a capacitor, or change out a part. Probably going to slow me down in terms of deployment.
Yeah, and you know, the majority of hams aren't at that technical level. Right. You know, I can attest to the fact that many of the hams that are involved in Arden today are relatively new hams, and you know, a good number of them are Unix guys who have found an interest in ham radio as a result of the success of Arden and the fact that you know, it's an open source Unix based system. So, you know, whether they have the technical ability to do that, I have my doubts.
Right. Yeah. I think if you told me, you know, we have some equipment and we've been playing around with it, and I've been involved in installing some of the equipment up here that links the Simi Valley area to Los Angeles, and there's some stuff that we spread out, Mount Wilson, Mount Verdugo, that's starting to talk to the hospitals that we support through our areas group. If they added the additional complexity that we needed to open up the equipment and make modifications, it would definitely slow down the expansion of this equipment. And there's already a concern from our level is like, how do you maintain it from a day-to-day standpoint? But if you're going to add that extra level, that could be quite confusing and would slow the thing down. From an education standpoint, what is it that we need to do to help the FCC understand or why this is a problem, or
we're chartered under Part 97 to to be a last resort communications facility for you know, our municipalities during times of disaster. And you know, there are many hams that have given a lot of their time and have given a lot of their money, their finances,
sure,
to put infrastructure like this in place. And with you know, presumably you know, goodwill from regulators, and you know, it's
we're supporting our served agencies. I'm sure that they're appreciating the work we're doing, or the stuff you've done in San Diego and San Bernardino County. I assume you're providing, you know, needed or important services to the first responders, the communities out there. How can we get them involved in reaching out to the FCC?
Yeah, that's a real good question, and I'd look to the other people on the call to elaborate on this. But you know, I am a backbone network implementer, owner, and maintainer, and I support the other organizations throughout Southern California that have served agencies.
Mm-hmm.
I have only one, and that's the San Diego Red Cross.
Okay,
which as of yet has not fully adopted this technology.
Yep. Well, let's ask. Let's see, David. Have you been able to? Can we hear you?
How's this?
It's better to talk a little closer to the mic or a little louder.
Yeah.
There you
okay.
go. So I'd like to introduce David Erickson, KB5UGF. I got that right, right, David?
That's correct.
And David, you're coming from South Texas. You guys have a deployment of Arden down there as well. And I know you've been involved in starting letter writing campaigns and other communications. First, tell us a little bit about what are you guys doing with Arden?
Okay. For starters, we're actually in North Texas, mm-hmm. In the Dallas-Fort Worth area, mm-hmm. The south central part of the Metroplex. We operate 16 full-time nodes and about a half dozen temporary nodes we use for special events. I've got to turn this monitor off. This is killing me.
Okay.
Well, it's going to take too long to do that. We'll do that later. We operate on three bands, 2.4, 3.4, and 5.8 gigahertz. We have five weather spotting mesh cameras for storm spotting. We serve two EOCs, the Mansfield EOC and the Johnson County EOC. There are CERT members in our group that are mesh operators. And we do special events that we use mesh equipment for, parades. A fire department has an event called the Fire Palooza. Then there's the Pickle Palooza Parade. Of course, there's JOTA and a field day that we set up mesh equipment for. Mm-hmm. As well as cameras, we do VoIP. We have repeater linking through one of our links. APRS assets. We have one eye gate right now. We're going to expand that to have a two-way eye gate and an additional single directional eye gate. And there's probably a few other things I'm leaving out, but we do make a lot of use of these bands. We do provide backup internet services to the EOCs also through internet gateways through our mesh.
So you guys are working directly with the first responders and the community emergency operations center. So I pulled up real quick. So it looks like, is it this group here just above Waco? There's a big.
There's a couple chunks. You'll see right between Dallas and Forth and uh-huh. Go south just a hair on the southern part of the Metroplex.
Uh-huh.
You can't see my cursor, I don't think.
No, but can you see on my screen? I've got the Arden
map.
Yeah,
sure
up.
Can.
Yeah.
Zoom in. Just go straight north and northwest from Houston, mm-hmm. and zoom in a couple clicks, because the Ellis County mesh is quite extensive also.
They're
just southeast of us.
Uh-huh.
They have even a more extensive system of more nodes, uh-huh. and they cover about two-thirds of their county.
So it looks like I
talked to one of their members at our meeting Friday night, and they are very concerned because all their backbone links are 3.4 gigahertz, and mm-hmm. they have a dual-layer last-mile system, user node system with omnidirectional 2.4 gig nodes and 5.8 sector nodes. Mm-hmm. They're all last-mile links, so even their 5.8s are
potentially
be affected by this. Yeah.
So you guys are working with the first responders and with your community. What are you guys doing to reach out to them to help with the fight, or you know, at least help to send letters to the FCC or communicate with them around the value that we're playing the amateur radio and the Arden network?
Well, fortunately,
plays.
Our emergency manager is also a club member, and he was there Friday night, and I had a short discussion with him and gave him the information packet that I handed out to everybody else at the meeting. As far as other people, we do need to get some other city officials involved. Mm-hmm. Am I breaking up now?
No, you sound okay. You're making it through. A little pop here and there, but it's fine.
Yeah, this is a too old of a computer for this. I've just decided it runs out of resources. We do have to get more of the city officials involved. Many of them are mentioned by name in the comment that I filed on behalf of our club to the FCC also.
Yeah, I've got your club site up here, and I did see that you got a letter, and there's some links here on what to do and how to do it. In fact, one of the links here brings up these templates that Andre had posted for both the Arden community, I guess. Andre, one of these is for the Arden community and the other is for the agencies that you guys support or that a community would support to file. And there's a difference, right? The HAM's asking for the support is probably, you know, valuable, but it's probably even more valuable to be working with the communities and the agencies which we serve and being able to get, you know, a city manager or a fire captain or a chief of police or an emergency operations manager to be able to send in these letters. I think that probably holds a lot of weight.
Yeah, I would agree. yeah, they're just taking a step back where there are two ways that you can file comments.
Okay.
One of them is pro forma, where you're given a text entry box and you write your comment, then you hit the submit button.
Mm-hmm.
The way these links are configured is they go to the a more advanced method,
mm-hmm.
Where you can actually attach documents and so forth. And in order to make these templates useful, I set up a Google Doc,
mm-hmm.
that they get their own personal copy of when they take the link.
Right.
Then they fill out the template and then they're given instructions on how to save it as a PDF.
Right.
And then subsequently they then, go to the FCC comment submission page and upload this PDF. the benefit of that approach, while more complex, is that, of course, you can conform your comment to what we have come up with as a reasonably good approach or a best practice for how you submit the comment. The thing that's important is that you really need to discuss, the 3 gigahertz issue and submit comments for its specific docket number, as opposed to the 5 gigahertz issue, which isn't even up for discussion yet. In fact, even today, the 3 gigahertz is just a proposal, and it hasn't been published yet in the register. So the formal comment period hasn't even begun.
Mm-hmm.
We suspect it will open up here in the next couple of weeks, though.
Right, but preparing or at least submitting this ahead of time, that'll have value to the FCC and to our community, we believe.
Yes, there's no problem submitting the comments early, and I'm just saying there's no absolute rush to.
Got it.
Let's structure the comment correctly. Make sure we're on topic before we go submit it.
Well, and I think interesting. One of the points that I read going through all the information that everybody shared with me was. And this comes up time and time again when we talk about dealing with the government or our served agencies, is we need to form, proper arguments to support what we want to do and, cover the right material, but not be, out of control or in charge or negative in any way, shape, or form. And I think that that's a really important thing to share with the audience. Grab these templates that are out there if you feel like, it's important to you if you're doing Arden and you're using these backbones, but make sure that the material you put together, is worded in such a way that, we're providing valuable community service and it is important to the community. And not rant and rave and, complain that they're taking our toys away, kind of approach. Jim, what do you got? Got anything to say about any of this?
You're picking up a cue there on the amateur radio community and how comments happen, and that's how we met when we were dealing with the hands-free law. Is everybody was going off, off in left field with any government comments and all that, rather than focusing on solutions. And so I think that's very important, and I think you guys are doing a great job of making sure the message is clear, I always suggest or ask if making sure that your congressman is not also involved in this, especially if they're on the telecommunications committee dealing with the FCC, because if this is a congressionally driven set of transitions for the spectrum, you'd want the politicians who are the ones that are actually setting the policy and direction for the FCC, get their attention, because otherwise... As I've perceived in other cases, it's like trying to complain to CHP about speeding tickets when it was the Senate and the Assembly that made the law and changed it at the last minute. The officer on the street is just the guy that has to write the paperwork.
Mm-hmm.
So some constructive direction there And as this come up, it's come up on a couple of other things. I always make sure to tell the folks in the various Facebook groups that, you know, don't forget your congressmen, because they're, you know, they're the actual boss of this whole situation here.
Right.
I'm looking at the map here, and I want to think that there's more activity on 5 and 3.4 than is shown here. And I'm gonna check with some local resources and figure out what's going on. I know one guy is using, he's got a commercial license for 3 gig.
So I think Andre has he'll have an answer for you for that. And as I believe, and you'll correct me if I'm wrong, you actually, to show up on this map here, and I'll pull it up on the screen, you actually have to go into your Arden software and put your Latin long. Is that right, Andre?
Yeah, that's right. Well, not only that, you have to actually click a series of buttons, of two buttons, in order to submit the data to our database before it appears on the map. And as a development team, which I am a member of, we think about 60% of the sites are actually represented here. It's not uncommon at all for locals that are building a network in a given area just to do so anonymously.
Okay. When I look at this too, I think, you know, there's a lot of stuff out there. There's a lot of equipment out there. But when I learned that you have to go through those steps, I do wonder too how many deployments aren't properly configured so that you can see them out there. So maybe that's something to talk to the folks that you're familiar with up there that might be doing this.
Make sure we're somewhat shy the same way about advertising the location repeater sites. There's a sort of a security situation, and you don't want to be the guy that causes everybody else to bother the landlord.
Yeah, I got it. Yeah, that's a good point.
You've got interference.
And you can anonymize that a little bit just by dropping, you know, the least significant digits off the Latin long coordinates. And
Right.
But, yeah, we deliberately cloak one of our locations also. And our other location in Johnson County is not on the map right now. We need to probably go ahead and put it on there, but just like you said, change the Latin lawn slightly just to obscure it.
Yeah.
So would there be another way if this is all on 44 and 45 net, is there a way to track actual hosts on those subnets and do an activity count that way?
Well, first of all, they're not on the 44 net, but, there are people who have written custom mapping software that will actually go out on the network and interrogate the nodes and pull back Latin lawn and build the maps that way. You still have to have the Latin lawn configured. It doesn't have these devices don't have GPS receivers in them that they know where they're at.
Yeah, they don't know. They don't know. They're not smart enough to know where they're at based on that.
Yeah. Well, my point is to the lightness of the numbers, getting people to self-report this activity, numbers seem to matter to members of Congress and people you're trying to influence. Yeah. And so if there's any way to quantify what that, get these people to do a little more self-admission.
So the way we're approaching that is we've gone through the exercise two or three times over the years, and 60% seems to be the number that are reporting. And so in my comments, I would extrapolate that to, you know, the 100% figure.
Okay.
Rather than use the 60% figure, because I'm pretty confident that number's pretty is right.
Yeah, and I get the concern about posting.
When you mentioned earlier that a lot of these people are coming in from the Unix world, and they're into this for the networking part of it. That seems to parallel a lot of what I'm seeing.
Oh, did I lose you all? Uh-oh. Okay. I lost something.
certainly an RF component in here that's important. But if we're going to be that, if all else fails, I think this network should be growing in leaps and bounds so that we've got enough backbone to support all this activity. So we're not tethering to cell phones and depending on cell sites. So there's a tremendous advantage in building this out and having it present that as infrastructure that we know is, you know, that's what we're here for, is to displace that infrastructure. And if it gets taken away from us, then, you know, we're back to 40 meters and NVIS and those kinds of things.
Well, I think so, when I got involved in this, Jim, when we started seeing this come out in the LA County area, Andre and the folks down south had been doing a lot, and the folks above us, Orff Beach, and a couple other guys up there, they're building it out. You know, it's just like your repeater system up there. You know, it's a bunch of volunteers with equipment and a couple dollars in their pockets burning a hole and wanting to, you know, serve the community. And I think, you know, we've talked about this, and through our 501c3, we've been fundraising to build out the Los Angeles infrastructure. And, you know, here's a map of some of the stuff that's going on here, in the Southern California area. Again, we always got to realize and remember that this is all, you know, my pocket, your pocket, Andre's pocket, David's pocket, and the volunteers in their area. And I'm not sure, and maybe Andre, you can correct me, that this is an infrastructure you guys are building out in your county, in your area, to provide emergency service and supplement, but it's not hardened or scaled such as, you know, if we truly have a real disaster, that it's going to replace anything. It's really just supplemental emergency communications.
Yeah, well, I think it's fair to say that that ham radio, to my knowledge, is not part of their business continuity plan of the agencies that that they support or we support. Mm-hmm. That it is a when all else fails. Now, having said that, many of these locations are hardened with backup power. Mm-hmm. Many of them are solar powered. Many of them have a level of survivability, maybe that goes beyond even some of the commercial offerings. So to that extent, they're hardened in many cases.
Got it. Okay.
I agree with some of the comments about supporting and supplementing. The when all else fails is an extreme situation, but a lot of times systems are still operational but overloaded in a disaster, or they just need an extra set of eyes out there, like for storm spotting. We work with the National Weather Service and mm-hmm. other counties and try to be their eyes. We don't have to put assets in the field when we have five well-located weather spotting cameras. So that's a supplemental rather than just a replacement, like you were saying. That's more likely going to be the scenario for us.
And you guys feed that into your EOC like on a 24/7 basis? That's in there all the time? They're always looking at those? Or they pull them up when they're worried about, they access them when they're worried about?
That computer is always up and running.
It's all right. Okay.
Except where somebody turned the power off last week for a couple of days, but we noticed that and got it right back up. So when they are activated, which I think were activated 11 times last year, mm-hmm. and they go sit down, all the radios are right in front of them. That computer monitor is up, connected to our mesh network, and they're ready to go.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, I know in our area here, when they had the Woolsey fire, some of that stuff about a year ago, the mesh network up in the Simi Valley area and in the surrounding areas, they were used. It's not something that the fire officials look at all the time or have access to, but you know, we had folks that volunteer with them, and you know, we're able to get, you know, camera pictures from some of those hilltops where there isn't any other infrastructure, to be able to show, you know, what's going on and directions and wind and whatever. So there is a vital resource we play or provide services to the community. And again, I think a lot of this is about reaching out to those folks that we work with in the community that aren't amateur radio operators to get them to help with this letter writing campaign. And I think that's what's great about the stuff, Andre, that you put up there to provide them those opportunities and those links. It's just about finding who's that right person in your amateur radio group to go talk to that person in the served agency in the right way so that they would be motivated to complete one of those submissions.
I think the concept of involving your congressman is outstanding. I recently toured Washington, D.C., and I got kind of a secondhand taste of how that mechanism works in Washington.
How the sausage is made, right?
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly. and you know, while I don't hold out a huge amount of hope for it, I think it's a wise to involve them as well. And we're also exploring the possibility of sitting down with the engineers at the FCC and educating them one-on-one on what we are doing. And you know, I would hate for the FCC to make a decision to go forward with this proposal uninformed of the negative consequences of doing so. And I'm convinced that they don't get it at this point, and I'm willing to shell out money out of my own pocket to fly to Washington and educate them.
Do you think where we're at today, and I know, as you said, the it's not actually open for comments yet, they're getting there. Do you think basically where we're at today, is there enough time to make that happen such that, you know, I know, again, the way the sausage gets made, we're talking about educating the engineers, and then the engineers have to talk to middle management, and, you know, middle management has to talk to the salespeople, and they're the ones that probably right now they're chomping at the bit to be able to sell this off to the cell service. Is there time to do that? I hope.
Well, I think there, yeah. Honestly, my answer would have to be, I don't know, but, but I suspect there is, because I learned through an individual that had actually participated in one such session with the FCC engineers around the encryption debate that's going on now at the FCC as well. And that only took place just before Christmas. So, you know, to me, I think that's late in the game, but the people that went obviously felt that it was still money worth being spent. So.
Okay. Well, great. I hope that will work out, and I wish you luck in that. So just to be respectful of everybody's time, I think we've covered what we're talking about. I do think that I really want to focus just a little bit more on what, we'll get everybody a chance to talk separately about this. What, Andre, from your perspective, what's the call to action? What should people do today if they should do anything? Or, you know, what's the timeline over the next, you know, period about what do we do? How do we support this? How do we, I don't want to say fight, but how do we challenge and educate the government so that they understand the value that we're bringing?
Yeah, I think, you know, thoughtful forming of your comments. I would be happy to read them and comment on them before they're submitted. If you have questions about them, you can forward them to icall@awro.net. I think that's wise. I think it's also wise to connect with your local congressman and senator and write them an email. You know, go visit them. Most of them have pretty open door policies, and shouldn't be afraid of approaching them, and tell them your story. And I think, and this was brought up earlier, I think almost most important is getting the served agencies to submit their comments, because that's, I mean, we can talk all day long about all the good things that we do altruistically, but you know, it's the served agencies that are really going to have to pay the price here.
Yeah.
Because if our services go away, they won't have them. you know, somebody asked me the other day at a ham luncheon what our alternative is. And I said, well, we're allowed to run a lot more power than they are. And they are, you know, they are in a position to having, when I say they, I mean the wireless ISPs that we compete with. And, you know, they under Part 15 must take all interference and not complain about it. You know, that isn't a very neighborly thing to do, but, you know, even with the equipment that Arden supports today, we're running much higher IERPs than wireless ISPs are. And as a result, we're able to struggle through the QRM that they present for us. So it won't mean Arden's demise, I don't believe, but it sure will have a tremendously negative impact.
It'll reshape it and require a lot of equipment change out, as I understand, and probably affect some of the bandwidth that we're enjoying today.
Mm-hmm. And the cost to the typical ham.
Sure, sure. Okay, good deal.
I wanted to go back and make
a quick you, David?
Comment about the numbers game.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry.
No.
The FCC is focusing on the numbers as they are right now. And yes, from that perspective, these bands do appear to be quite underutilized. But you have to consider that where we've come just in the last few years, just 5 years ago, 3.4 gigahertz was really in the hands of a few hobbyists, the AMSAT folks, some guys with some transverters. And if you look how it's grown exponentially in the next few years and extrapolate that out into the next few years, I think they would get an idea that, you know, we are just in our infancy and using the capabilities of this band right now.
Mm-hmm. So if we're looking at the numbers on the Arden site, and we're talking maybe 60% representative, we're talking maybe 400, at least 3 gigahertz nodes out there. Does that sound like a good number? Anybody? Andre or?
If you're taking those numbers off that document or that news article, then I'd support them. I actually calculated those numbers myself, so I support them.
Okay. All right. And so again, back to you, David. So as a closeout, what would you want people to know or do or take out
Everybody
of this?
Everybody needs to write an intelligent comment to the FCC. Mm-hmm. You can use the template that Andre's created, but I would suggest using that as a guideline and craft something in your own words that suits your particular application of these frequencies and submit that as a regular, what they call an ordinary filing. I think that may have more impact than an express filing. Mm-hmm. But filing it at all is going to help. We need to get the numbers up. We need to get awareness, not just from hams, not even just from first responders and other public officials, but the general public. Many of them could be educated as to the benefits that these services our mesh networks provide. So we need to reach out beyond just our clubs and our served agencies and one way or another, just by word of mouth or by email, doing videos like I'm doing right now, just to try to get the word out, but sufficiently so to motivate people to file those intelligent comments. And Andre, I'm glad to hear that the window of opportunities a little wider than I thought. I thought they'd already filed it with the Bureau of Registry. So it'd be interesting to know what kind of timeline we're looking at too.
Yeah, I can't guess, but the suspicion that I've heard is sometime in January they'll publish it, and that'll open the formal comment period.
Very good.
All right. Well, we'll keep an eye on it, and I'll definitely post out in our Facebook group and the Elmer's group when we know the comments open, and you know, repost links to this as well. Anything else from you, David, before we close out?
We need to nudge the ARRL into not only watching the proceedings of the FCC, but the subcommittees in Congress that craft these mandates while they're still working on them. And like has been said, get in touch with your congressman and voice your opinion at that stage of the game.
Yep. I know a couple of our officials here in in our area and some across the country will actually see the show, and hopefully they'll get involved. How about you, Jim?
Well, and yeah, there's good points all around in that. And as I've gone through what the FCC published, you had to look real hard to find anything that alluded to amateur radio. And there's nothing really mentioned in the 3 gigahertz documentation. And there is some allusion to Part 97 or amateur services in the other. And that strikes me that the comments to the congressman need to educate them where there's a piece of us in this, because it's not obvious from what is sitting on their desk that there are actual citizens involved. They're just looking at whatever industry group wants to make use of this stuff. And, you know, unlicensed is sort of like unwashed, or, you know, they may take that as CB radio or whatever else and not be able to put any context to, you know, that there's some qualification that goes behind what we're doing here. And then, I don't know if anybody's considered, you know, a negotiating point here of, you know, can we keep 100 megahertz or can we keep 50 megahertz of some of this, rather than, you know, because this is an all or nothing game as far as, you know, what's being asked to make a change. You know, the flip side of that is, okay, we realize you're probably going to take some of it. Do you really need all of it? So what's our budget for spectrum? You know, how much budget do we need in that spectrum, plus or minus some compromises? And what's the spectrum budget that these other groups need? And if they want this whole big chunk, you know, if some of that industry group hasn't acted and used it in the 5 or 10 years they've had access to it, what's to say they're going to make full use of that in the next 5 or 10 years, if they get it all? So there's a flip side of that is, you know, what do we really want? You know, what can we come to the table with as an option that doesn't put us out of the equipment business? Because as you said, the stuff that's at 3 gigs won't move down to this new section. We lose everything unless we start homebrewing our own equipment for those bands, which is not easy. And, you know, the guys that are doing hotspots and the digital stuff aren't handy with a soldering iron. They're not going to be able to make a microwave circuit board.
Well, thank you for that. Let me just hitchhike on that, because I think I think there is an opportunity to suggest to the FCC that in regulation that these companies that are going to jump into the 3.3 to 3.5 gigahertz subband, you know, perhaps they could mandate that these same devices operate all the way down to 3.1 to support the ham radio effort.
Well, I would say too that just like the debacle with 220, there was no backing out of that. Once we lost that couple megahertz of 220, there was no replacement plan if that original project failed. And so the FCC's got that spectrum to do what they want with no provision, and we never asked to go get it back. So a little performance bond in this is, you know, we're going to give you a little bit and see how you do in the development, because the last people who asked for the spectrum haven't used it in so much time. And let's not make this a one-way street, if at all possible. You know, open the relief valve on this if there isn't performance. So it's not an entire loss.
Okay. That's well, what I got. It sounds like there's stuff for us to do. I'm going to post this up. I hope everybody out there shares it. And if you're watching this, you got to the end of the show, please share this with other hams that you know, other folks that are involved, whether they're involved with the ARDN network or not, they're thinking about it. We've seen a lot of value in our Aries group, and I know some of the other volunteer groups out here are using it as well. Please consider going out and looking at the links that I'm going to share below the shows, to the letter templates that Andre posted, and make a comment and reach out to your congressman and your served agencies and friends and relatives, and let's do something about this.
Thank you, David.
Thank you. So I'm going to try to bring everybody up on the same time here, but I might crash everything. Okay, we're all here, except for my Hall of Mirrors thing, but that's all good. This was Amateur Radio, Ham Radio Now, episode number 415, FCC reallocation. And mostly we talked about the 3 gigahertz, but there's also potentially some changes with the 5 gigahertz stuff. And when that comes up, we may do another recap or at least post some information about the letter writing and communication campaign around that. I'll assume none of you guys have ever got to the end of the show except for maybe Mr. Aspinwall. And we always close out the show with the bad radio stuff because that's what Gary, who I inherited this show from, did because someone said, don't ever do this. So Jim and I will start it off, and if you guys get the end of it, jump right in. Again, this was Ham Radio Now, episode number 415. Thanks for joining us. Over.
And
out.
Out.
There
out.
You go. And then we do this flyout thing. Okay. Hey, guys, I want to thank you very much. I'm going to hit the stop recording.